Hi guys, this is gsnhome.com and I'm here with the unboxing of the Sony Xperia 5 Mark II, Sony's fall flagship. It was unveiled close to the end of September and here we are in October getting it. They could have easily called it the Sony Xperia Mark I, they could have easily called it Sony Xperia 1 Mark II Compact, because that's exactly what it is. It shares most of the features of the Xperia 1 Mark II, however it's smaller, more compact, has a smaller diagonal and quits the 4K resolution in favor, well, of Full HD but with a higher refresh rate. The back camera is pretty much the same, minus the time of flight, but we'll get through all of those soon. Now, this is quite a pricey phone still at $949, and in some countries you're getting a bonus, a pair of headphones, the wireless ones, the Sony WF-1000XM3, which actually aren't half bad. It's a narrow phone, as you can definitely see by how easy I am reaching areas of the screen, and it's also a long phone. Okay, it's an unboxing, so before we focus on the actual phone, I think we should focus on what's inside the box. And I remember everyone my plea towards Sony to stop putting so much paper in the box. So much paper. Unless it's made to some ecologic way which doesn't involve killing trees. Anyway, lots of documents here. And info about the handset. And then we have the charger, which has an USB-C connector and promises 18 watts, even though the phone itself charges at 21 watts max. And then we have the cable. So the 18 watt charger is here, and this is the cable which goes from USB-C to USB-C. Nothing out of the ordinary, and no pair of headphones here, even though in some countries the Xperia 1 Mark II had headphones here. Okay, so this is pretty much it so far. Let's go to the handset. Now, first impression, it feels like it could slip from my hand. There's a lot of glass, well, with a mirror pattern on the backside, rounded edges, and quite slippery. So there's Gorilla Glass at the backside, Gorilla Glass at the front side, and an aluminum frame in between. We also have IP65, IP68 certification, and well, if you want measurements, 8 millimeters is the waistline here, and 163 grams makes it one of the lightest flagships of 2020. Now, an interesting feature, an extra physical button. This is probably one of the only 5 physical button phones I've seen lately. So, 2 volume buttons, camera button, the new Google Assistant button, and also the power button here, which is flat and includes the fingerprint scanner. So, 5 physical buttons on one side, and these actually aren't very comfy. They're too well embedded to be comfy. They should protrude more if you ask me. Okay, so we gotten that out of the way. I think we can now cover other specs and features, and we have to turn down the brightness because it's truly bright. Now, what you're seeing here is an OLED screen. It's a 6.1-incher. The resolution isn't 4K this time around. It's actually 2520 over 1080 pixels. The novelty here is actually the fact that you're getting to play with 120 hertz. So if you go here, high refresh rate, you can activate it, and you're definitely going to see an improvement if you're navigating on a website. And let's load up gsnhome.com. You should be able to hear, to see an extra fluidity in going through lists. And of course, watching videos, playing games should also feel impressive with this higher refresh rate. Keep in mind, the predecessor and the Xperia 1 Mark II only had 60 Hz, so it's quite the bump. Now, going further, we find the Qualcomm Snapdragon 865 CPU inside, but only the Snapdragon 865, the simple one, not the plus one, accompanied by 8 gigs of RAM and 128 or 256 gigabytes of storage. Plus, there's also a micro SD card slot. And as usual for Sony, you're not getting a metal key in the box. You have to use your fingernails and pry this open, this little tray, which includes the micro SD and a nano SIM. And once you insert it, the device will reset itself, which is a feature which feels like something out of 2011 or something like 5 or 6 years ago. Anyway, speaking of things which feel a bit antiquated nowadays, the battery doesn't sound very impressive, 4000 mAh battery, but for such a skinny phone, sacrifices had to be made. It charges at 21 watts, and the folks of Sony have promised us that this handset should be able to juice up at 50% in 30 minutes. I'll believe it when I see it. When it comes to music, you're getting stereo speakers and there's nothing here. This slit is actually one of the speakers. I hope you can see it properly, this slit here. And the other one is the earpiece at the top side. Those deliver a stereo experience. And aside from that, we have the dynamic vibration motor, which complements the experience, the dynamic vibration system. On the connectivity front, we are treated to, I would say, the usual stuff for a flagship nowadays. I'm talking about 5G, Wi-Fi 6, there's Bluetooth 5.1, GPS, NFC, and the USB-C 3.1 port. Once again, security comes in the form of a flat, set-placed power button with a fingerprint scanner embedded. And finally, we have reached the cameras. Here at the top side, Sony refuses to put a notch or a punch hole. We have an 8-megapixel camera with a special 5-axis gyroscope aided electronic stabilization. This is the same 8-megapixel camera they've been using for about 2 or 3 generations. They had it on the Xperia 5, they had it on the Xperia 1 Mark II, and probably also on the Xperia 1, the first one. At the back side, things are changing, or well, maybe not. So, 3 cameras, each of them 12 megapixel in sensor size. Now, one of them is the main one, the 12 megapixel shooter, is packed with optical image stabilization. We also have f1.7 aperture, there's dual pixel phase detection autofocus, and a 24 millimeter focal length. Then comes the ultra wide 12 megapixel camera, and the 12 megapixel telephoto camera with only 3x optical zoom. That one also has optical image stabilization. Here we have the LED flash, and a novelty for this camera, which Sony says is the first time everybody or anybody has been doing it, is that you can shoot 4K, 120 frames per second in HDR. All of those combine. There's here the promise of Zeiss optics, and well, this is pretty much it. Of course, there's more to cover. There is the eye tracking feature, which tracks the eyes of the person you're filming or photographing, and also tracks the eyes of pets. Yes, pets are also included in the equation. Okay, and we go here to see the typical camera interface, exactly as we've had it on the Xperia 1 Mark II, and you can switch like this between the modes, the cameras, ultra wide or telephoto like this. We have the modes here. There is pro photo, slow motion, portrait, selfie, creative effect, and panorama. And Sony also bundled the Cinema Pro app, which we've seen first on the Xperia 1 last year, and can help you create Spielberg-like motion pictures with quite a few options here, with special filters and lots of options to tweak. So you're shooting in 4K 24 frames per second, and you're doing quite a few changes. Okay, so on the software front, this is actually, well, Android 10. With Xperia UI on top. Gone are the days when Sony offered us first an implementation of Android. So usually on the Xperia XZ1, if you remember, they were the first with a flavor of Android. So that's no longer available. Now, aside from that aspect, I should mention this is a Call of Duty mobile optimized phone. As you know, Xperia is sponsoring the Call of Duty contest. That's why they're promoting that thing. And I think we've covered pretty much everything. And I should also mention that this is a phone which plays nicely with a PlayStation 4. You can use PlayStation 4 remote play. You can connect a DualShock 4 joystick to it. And now I think we have covered everything. Sony brags about the fact that they're using the DSLR Sony Alpha technology for this camera. Well, I guess we'll have to wait and see. One thing to remember here, and one thing I discovered on the Xperia 1 Mark II, is that using this phone on auto mode for photos and video doesn't do it justice. It's only the pro mode which reveals what it's actually capable of. Okay, so this has been it. It's definitely a $900 phone, which I'm going to have to test over the next days. I'll be back with a full review very soon. Bye-bye.